Okay, welcome to the Overs Hamburg Stammtisch. We meet more or less on a regular basis here. We try to do it monthly. Today it's up to Björn to give his presentation or his update about JewShop. Everybody who's participating probably knows what JewShop is. Otherwise, I'm sure Björn will give a very good present an intro about it for people who are just interested in JewShop and don't have a clue yet. It's kind of a regular basis that Björn does a JewShop presentation because every end of the year he has great new things to present. What's new in JewShop? Last year he did it for German Overs Day. The year before he did it at German Overs Day. I think also 3 years ago you did that. No?
Yeah, kind of. I think it was 4 years in a row now.
Yeah.
3 or 4.
Yeah. Yeah. You give a lot of presentations all over the world and also for other organizations, as I've heard. So I'm really curious what the JewShop 12 update brings to us. So I will pass the torch now to Björn. Welcome, Björn.
Thank you, Dirk. So let's start the screen share again, and let's go. So JewShop 12. So the last JewShop update I gave actually at the last year's German Overs Day. That was on JewShop version 9, major release 9, and I think then the one before I had at the Hamburg Stammtisch was also 2019, but it must have been pretty early in 2019, I think. So you missed a little bit if you have not looked into the JewShop since the last release that I showed either here or at the German Overs Day. So we will go through different novelties of the application. And in the first section, for those who have never seen the JewShop before, don't worry, you will get at least a rough idea of what it is, because I will show a few fancy things. Because I would actually like to start with some business novelties in the JewShop. So the stuff that the money guys get excited about, right? So great new things to squeeze more money out of our customers. What the JewShop actually got is a completely rewritten customer experience when it comes to ordering stuff, tracking your orders, but also the JewShop now has its completely full-fledged deluxe membership, right, where you can actually get cheaper delivery prices and faster delivery, but you also get more bonus points and some special discounts and stuff like this. So let me quickly show you how that looks like if you shop at the JewShop in version 12. So I have my JewShop already started right here. I'm running the latest version from the development branch, so that's why it's a snapshot release. And this is basically the starting screen. If you really had the last JewShop impression with version 8 point something, then you even missed our complete user interface facelifting. So that's why it might not look that familiar like before. But I assume that you will be able to find all the things you previously knew and tried out in the application anyway. So let's do some shopping. I will not bother doing a full registration because now the JewShop also has a very convenient demo user with an even more convenient password. So let's log in with this demo account and let's put some stuff into our shopping basket. And I would say let's go for some of the new things, right? So things we didn't have in the past, like for example, these awesome face masks. And those are no fake, right? They actually they actually exist. I myself have two of these, just for some Corona entertainment. We also have holographic stickers right now, and not just the boring white ones, right? So, but really nice, shiny, blinky ones. Very, very nice. What else? Maybe you don't know, I actually made digital versions of the OWASP Snakes and Ladders games for web applications and mobile applications, and you can play those with a tabletop simulator on Steam if you want. So let's get one of these two, and let's also get, too bad, this one is sold out. Well, okay, never mind. And just for fun, also some strawberry juice. So let's see what the shopping basket has to say. For some reason I didn't, I couldn't add any masks because they were sold out too. So, well, I will have to settle with my strawberry juice and snakes and ladders then, I guess. So let's get a bit more. So we actually have still lovely rounding problems like you expect, right? So let's go for checkout now. And with the demo account, everything is set up already. As a completely new user, you would now have to create a new shipping address, right? But the demo account already has one. So let's select the shipping address. Didn't have that before. We have to choose a delivery speed. So between 1 day and standard delivery, we can choose. So let's say, well, I would like to get fast delivery, actually. Okay, let's continue. And also brand new, the juice shop, in the juice shop, you now actually have to pay for stuff. And you can do so either with your registered credit cards. Of course, you can also add new ones, but there's also an in-store digital wallet where you can pay with, right? So that's one option to do this. If you register a new credit card, just for those who might actually be a little bit, I don't want to put my credit card number into juice shop. Well, we actually help you a little bit not to shoot yourself in the foot by having expiry years that only start at 2080, right? So it shouldn't be too easy to actually put a valid credit card in here accidentally, I guess. Also, we don't ask for the CVV at all. Good. So let's pay with the wallet balance. And here we go. Okay, I didn't order enough to get some bonus points. Well, never mind. Let's place the order. We have to click harder. Let's try that again. Okay, doesn't want. Let's see. Maybe I did something wrong. Fast delivery. Let's try credit card instead. Okay, credit card seems to work. Didn't like my wallet balance for some reason. So thank you for your purchase. You now get an actual order overview here and a direct link to the tracking page where you can now see that, as promised, right, the delivery should happen in 3 days. Awesome. You can also later do some actual orders tracking, and or you can actually see all your previous orders here in the order history, right? And the demo account, as you can see, has a lot of open orders already. Oh, and it seems it actually took all my orders when I clicked. It just didn't refresh the screen. So now I will get a lot of strawberry juice. So this works just fine, right? And I could also, for example, try to become a deluxe member here. So if I do, again, I have to pay 49 whatever currency. So let's see if I can actually do that. And yay, now I'm a deluxe member and I can shop for cheaper prices, for example. So that's one of the main things that happened on the business side, right? There's one other business feature that we are really proud of that was written this year in the Google Summer of Code. That is our support chatbot. And our support chatbot actually blends NLP, AI, and ML into a delicious Turing test cocktail because it's so amazingly smart and very helpful. So let me show you how our chatbot works. If you are logged in, you can just go to the support chat menu. And typically the chatbot will first ask you what your name is, if you've never spoken to it, right? So, okay, let's give it a name. Let's give my own name. Localhost. Nice to meet you, Localhost. I'm Juicy. Okay. So, I can talk to it. I can also say goodbye, but maybe I don't want to. Maybe I want to know, for example, some simple questions like, Juicy, how much is apple juice? And then Juicy will amazingly tell me that apple juice costs $1.99. Isn't that great? I could also ask, how much costs OWASP? Because I might be interested in buying OWASP. And that wasn't not specific enough, it seems, so it couldn't actually find anything. So I can ask, for example, how much is Juice Shop? Ah, too bad. How much is yes. Ah, okay. How much is orange? No typos, please. Orange juice. Okay, so as you can see, it can find some products and others not so easily, but it kind of learns a little bit the more you ask it. Also, you can ask other questions like, do you know anything on blockchain, right? Because why wouldn't you ask that? And of course, Juicy doesn't. You can even go further and ask like, can I please have a discount? And then Juicy typically freaks out. Because no, I can't even really read that. Oh, I can't hear you too much. Please check your internet connection or something. Okay, so there seems to be some slight problems with Juicy here. Yeah, so that's our chatbot. It has some more functions, but we will come back to those in the at a later point in time.
Björn. While yes. We are at questions, do you want me to collect all the questions?
Yes, and, actually, I would suggest that when we reach a point for a next topic, then we can actually do all the questions that have come up so far.
Okay.
While doing good. So, I would actually go back to the screen and admit a few more people who might have come in by now. So. Any questions?
Yeah, there were a couple of questions. One really nasty question. I mean, the people who always look for bargains was complaining when whether there are any Black Friday deals.
No, JewShop doesn't have any Black Friday deals, but there are other special holidays where JewShop has special discounts. And those are even better, I would say.
Okay.
Because they are also hacking challenges to be exploited.
Ah, cool. Okay. one question which popped up in my mind is whether the bot, the artificial bot you have there, whether that can be hacked, whether that is there's a challenge also.
Would you be surprised if it can be?
No, I would be surprised okay. If not.
Then let's wait for the hacking chapter because, of course,
okay.
It can also be hacked, yes.
Okay.
I think that was actually part of the Summer of Code Ah,
stealing
okay.
job to write a chatbot that is more broken than actually working. I mean, as you have Okay.
seen, I mean, and it's not even that smart, to be honest, right? It's just it plays smart, but it not really is.
Okay.
But
So
one fun fact about the chatbot, it's also part, I mean, you probably know our customization ability for the Juice Shop, right? So where you can write your own custom front-end theme with different colors, different icons and all. You can also customize the learning data that goes into the Juice, the chatbot at startup, right? So you can basically teach the chatbot your complete own set of phrases and responses and everything.
okay, cool. I think there were no further questions, so
Okay.
if
Then let's go into the, I hope, actually interesting stuff. That's the new hacking features that we actually have. So that's basically where the money that the business guys made flies out of the window then. First thing that was added quite recently is a tutorial mode. So we have some tutorial scripts for quite some time called hacking instructor scripts, right? Which actually teach you or help you a little bit to solve some of the easier challenges. But what we now also added is a tutorial mode that kind of forces you through a number of these challenges so that you don't by accident start with a really hard challenge and get frustrated because you cannot solve it, right? So this is actually meant to be very beginner friendly and to guide you through a couple of challenges before you let go and can actually start with hacking the entire application. So how does that work? To show that, I just have to quickly restart the shop in its tutorial configuration. That shouldn't take too long. And I will use it from an incognito window so I don't have any cookies or such stuff interfering. So when you start the Juice Shop in tutorial mode, you basically see the same welcome screen that you always see with the difference that you now cannot just easily get rid of it, right? So to get rid of it, you must actually accept the help of the Juice Shop's hacking instructor, who actually, just to show this quickly, has a little face mask here for protection as well right now. So I don't know when we can remove that, maybe 2025 or something. But yeah. And these little scripts, and you probably have seen those already, basically give you some hints on what you should do, and then they wait until you actually do the right next step, and then you can basically continue. So for example, this script will now wait until I open the browser DevTools with F12, and then it will give me some more hints on how to find the scoreboard and stuff like this. So to make it short, I mean, we probably all know what the URL of the scoreboard for the Juice Shop is, which is that here. So let's just visit it. And now I get my congratulations from the script. Okay, very nice. And now the scoreboard looks a little bit simplified, right? So there's only four challenges, each with one star difficulty, and all these lovely filter buttons don't work, right? And they all tell me when I hover over them that I have to complete, here in this case, I have to complete all one star tutorial challenges before I can do the next tier, right? And here all the filters are completely disabled until I complete all tutorial challenges. So what I would have to do now is actually do these additional challenges here, which is not that hard. And if you never used the Juice Shop before and don't want to get spoilers, then please close your eyes for a few seconds now. So let's do a very quick cross-site scripting here. Okay, done. And go back. There we go. Solved. Reading the privacy policy. That's really easy. That's actually really just a joke and not a real challenge. because all you have to do to solve that is log in. And then actually go to the privacy policy page. Assuming that nobody ever does that in real life, this is actually a juice shop challenge. So, almost done. And only one challenge is remaining. That is also one of the newer ones, the bonus payload challenge, which is essentially the same attack vector like the DOM XS as before, just with a slightly more entertaining payload. So I paste this over here. And now, I don't know if you can hear the sound of my computer playing some music here. But no matter if you do or not, you should really try out this one and then listen to this whole track come to the end, because this is basically the long-promised full 3-minute version of the Juice Shop jingle that Brian Johnson produced and sang for us and recorded and published on SoundCloud with, by now, I think, almost 17,000 plays on that platform. I suppose most of those by our continuous integration pipeline, but never mind, it still counts, right? Obviously, for SoundCloud. So this is really worth your time, right? So if you listen to one of the teasers I played at the, I think it was 2018 at the German OWASP Day, when I played the teaser, like 30 seconds, this is the full thing and it's great. So now let's go back to the scoreboard. And as you can now see, I have solved all the one-star challenges, and now I have three additional challenges with tutorials that I have to solve to actually continue, right? And this would be then followed up by some three-star challenges, and then you're basically good to go. And all these challenges have these scripts which you can start to get some help, right? So you don't have to start completely on your own. You can have help for all of these. And that's basically the whole idea of the tutorial mode. Good. So we also added a few other things you might have noticed already on the scoreboard, at least in the full version. We added some tags for the challenges. Every challenge had a category right from the beginning, I think, of the Juice Shop. But we now also wanted to somehow cluster them into different, with some different attributes, and make sure that you can get a bit more information on what you're dealing with here, right? So one of the first challenges I actually added was shenanigans, because there are so many unserious challenges in the Juice Shop by now that it might actually be useful to point out, okay, this one is not really serious, right? Another one is called contraption. So it's in German we would say, I guess we would say, rumgebastel. So these are challenges which have been not, they are not unserious, but the underlying security vulnerability is not really realistic. So it's a little bit forced or artificial. We have an OSINT tag to show that this challenge involves some internet research, or you have to perform some social stalking to get on your hands on some personal information, stuff like this. We have good practice challenges, where we actually don't want to point out some bad vulnerability, but actually want to promote some good security practice instead. Like, for example, having a security.txt file, which describes how you accept vulnerability disclosure, stuff like this. Danger zone are the challenges which are considered actually dangerous, which is why they are turned off on all Docker and Heroku instances, by default at least. You can turn them on if you want, but those actually allow remote code executions or other things where we are not not really interested in anyone by accident deploying those somewhere on a cloud platform. Some challenges are marked as good for demos because they are good for stuff like presentations here, for example. Others are marked as prerequisites because it makes sense to solve them first before you can tackle some other challenge or more challenges. Brute force challenges have their own tag, and tutorials have two. And last but not least, we have one for code analysis, where you really probably have to dig into the source code of either the application itself, so the front-end source code, for example, that you get in the browser, or the code of some third-party library, like, for example, the chatbot, to actually get anywhere. Okay, one other thing that is new is mitigation links on the scoreboard, and you might have already spotted those. So let me close this one here. So if I go back here to the scoreboard, a lot of challenges have this additional button here right next to the solved icon once you actually made it, right? And then you can click here, and typically you get sent to the corresponding OWASP cheat sheet that is actually giving you then some advice on how to prevent that vulnerability from getting into your own applications in the first place. So that's just a nice additional information. Also, the JuShop now has officially 100 challenges. So we sat around at 90 something for quite some time, but now we actually made it. So there's 100 actual hacking challenges. I guess that will be hard for any other Vuln app to bypass. So, and here you can see the category breakdown, which now it looks pretty smooth and nice with round and even numbers, which is great, right? So all these different categories of vulnerabilities exist in the JuShop, and there's at least two of each kind in the application, up to 16, for example, for sensitive data exposure, or 11 injection vulnerabilities, etc. And the new challenges that have been added, I only listed the ones that I could think of that came after release 9, so after the presentation from last year's German OWASP Day. So, and one or two basically jumped into the eye immediately, revolving the chatbot, right? So there's a bully chatbot challenge, and there's a kill chatbot challenge. Bully chatbot is actually rather easy. Maybe you remember I tried to ask the chatbot for a coupon code or for a discount, and it might actually give you one at some point in time, right? Maybe you just have to pressure it a little bit more. So just ask nicely very often, and maybe you will actually get a coupon code for the JuShop you can use. Killing the chatbot, on the other hand, is a lot harder, but also possible. And it's important to understand that in the JuShop, until now, everything ran in the same process, right? Even the database is just a file, and that is accessed in the same server process. But the chatbot is now the first actual side process that is running alongside the main one, right? So it's actually running independent, and it can still be killed horribly with some remote code execution vulnerability. But to actually find out how that works might actually require a bit of research on the source code of the chatbot itself. Okay, there's lots of other interesting stuff. For example, we also have these three challenges, which are all happening in one other nice new screen in the JuShop that I didn't show yet. That is our photo wall. So we actually learned from Instagram, and you can now upload photos to the juice shop, right? And you can give them the little captions here, and people can tweet about them. And so here are some default ones, but you can upload your own once you're logged in. And we have two geo location based challenges, basically, where you have to find out the favorite hiking place of someone. And also the former workplace of someone else. So, and both these pictures actually tell you a lot. One in a more visual way and one in a more meta way, right? And then there's also this lovely image here that seems to be broken for some reason. That's actually the third one here, the missing encoding challenge. Because here somehow during the upload, it seems something went wrong. But if you are actually able to fix this encoding problem that happens here, you are able to see a very cute picture of our family cat. And this gives you another challenge solved, actually. It's only a one star, but it's a really, really cute one. So we also added a few more SQL related things, like you have to extract now the database schema itself from the database. We have SQL injection, and also log in with an user account that is not even in the database and without actually adding it to the database, but still convince the application that you are regularly logged in, etc. So lots of interesting stuff. And we then also have one nice new convenience feature, which is a local backup. So if you remember, maybe the Juice Shop stores all progress in cookies, and that means, or even the hacking progress is stored in a code in a cookie. So if you shut down the server, like you saw when I just restarted it some time ago, and you started back up, then visit the server for the first time with a browser where your cookies are still set, then all the progress is restored, right? So now that is all good and fine, but sometimes you might want to actually have a local copy of your progress, and maybe not even your, not just your progress, but maybe also your settings, right? For example, I could change the settings here to German, right? And now let's save a copy here of the Juice Shop status, so I get a little JSON file. That's it. So now if I kill the server and let's close this browser window here and let's start the server again. And now, once it's up, I visit the server with a completely brand new browser window in a browser I typically don't use. Did it get? Let me just make sure that it doesn't have any things here already that it shouldn't have. Language? No. Okay. Oh, I started in tutorial mode accidentally. I didn't want to do that. I just wanted the normal mode. So that's why I couldn't close the welcome banner. So let's see. Now that should work. Here we go. I can dismiss this. So if I go to the scoreboard now, only tells me that I solved the scoreboard challenge, but all my other progress is gone. But I can now restore my progress here from this lovely file. Let's see. And as you can see, now all my settings, German settings here, the filters that I had, everything is back to normal, right? So good. That's the local backup, and it's really a very simple format. nothing too fancy. So before we talk about the integration stuff, let's see if there are any questions that piled up so far. Dirk, I can't hear you.
Sorry, yeah.
No problem.
One thirsty attendee was asking where the race conditions were in your diagram.
Race conditions? Our race conditions, yeah, are not a category of their own. We have some. I'm not really sure where they are. I think one is part of an injection vulnerability. There are two or three race conditions or race condition style challenges, but they are not their own category because we don't have so many.
Okay. Otherwise, the pile is quite empty. There was one asking how JuShop is going to be installed on localhost, but I think he got enough help, right?
Mm-hmm. I hope so.
In the chat,
solvable by the GitHub.
There were a lot of chats here, so I think by Krishna got right enough help. So let's proceed.
Okay, sounds good. So let's leave the hacking part and go into some integration novelties that have been added. So the JuShop actually, it has its own API for its own as its own backend, right? And the scoreboard, for example, is filled with all the challenges by requesting things from the challenges API. Of course, you could always integrate with that if you wanted to. And the JuShop also, for an eternity, is using a YAML file to actually declare all its hacking challenges, which are then later generated and put into the database. And you can also integrate with that YAML file for quite long. Actually, I just want to show one quick example where we are actually doing this. So in the full screen, please. So if we go to the OWASP JuShop website, there's, for example, a challenge overview here, and these tables here for the categories and the set challenges, this is basically coming directly from the JuShop data itself, right? So I don't edit those manually. So with every release, this is automatically updated from the actual JuShop data. We also have a list of the different tags here as well. And in the same way, also the tutorials list is also completely generated and not edited manually anymore. But we also have some other nice integration features now. One is, let's say, a work in progress. That's the solution webhook. So you can at startup define via an environment variable a URL, which you would like to get notified to whenever a challenge is solved. And when you pass in this solution webhook URL, you always get this kind of payload when you solve a hacking challenge. There are still some bugs in this. Yannick has already fixed it, I guess, but I can't merge it right now because our Travis build server is not working due to missing credits. But yeah, let's hope this will be fixed soon. So the idea here in general is you just get an information on what challenge has been solved, when that happened, and also where this was issued from, right? So then you get the host name and the operating system, etc., of where this challenge solution came from. The idea is, if you, for example, have a centralized learning platform or tracking system where you want to check the progress of different students, for example, you could give everyone their own individual webhook URL or not give it to them, but pass it into their centrally hosted instances. And then you actually get a notification whenever they actually solve something. So you can actually see if they are still working or if they are just playing around or not making any progress. This is actually being implemented currently or adopted for the first time, I think, in our own multi-juicer platform. That's why Yannick actually noticed the bug in this whole thing. And also the OWASP Security Knowledge Framework team is also planning to implement this, because they recently, I mean, they offer labs that you can spin up in containers in their own framework, in their own platform. And they recently added JuiceShop as a lab provider to their system. And now the next step would also be to spin up JuiceShop instances, for example, for a specific challenge, then wait for the webhook to be called, and then send the user, for example, back to the learning platform and maybe present them with some kind of badge or I don't know. And some achievement of their work, of their exercise. Another thing that we have is a lovely new dashboard that exists in the JuiceShop in the form of a JSON template that you can just import into Grafana. And this consumes all the metrics that our also new Prometheus metrics endpoint provides. And there's a lot of lovely information there, actually. So let me just quickly show you the Grafana dashboard that I'm generating on my lousy Raspberry Pi 3, which is consuming the data from the official demo instance of the JuiceShop. So the one running on demo.oas.juiceshop. So this is one instance hosted on Heroku, which is publicly accessible. And let's see how that is doing. So in the README of the JuiceShop, it says that you're not supposed to hack this instance. So as you can see, people really take that advice serious, because it's only a couple of challenges have been solved on that instance. You can see information about the HTTP requests happening, if any file uploads were made recently, what the startup time was, and where the most time was spent, and the usual, of course, CPU, memory, and all that stuff. But you can also get some business insight, right? So like how many social interactions happened in the JuiceShop. Complaints, feedback, reviews, stuff like this. How many users signed up? How many orders were placed? How many coins do people have in their digital wallets, et cetera, et cetera? How many Deluxe users have signed up? So all the things you always wanted to know about your JuiceShop instance, how much money is it really making for you? This is all visible here in this lovely dashboard. Okay. So, good. Any questions about that part? Because if not, then I only have one final unavoidable slide left.
There was one question regarding integration.
Yeah.
Because of the integration, is there progress in the latest version with CTF frameworks? In brackets, Facebook CTF.
Progress. I mean, it works for a long time. So you can use the JuiceShop CTF command line tool to generate data for CTFD, Facebook CTF, and also for root the box now. And all of those should actually work. For CTFD, I'm regularly using that myself. I think root the box is also used quite frequently. And I guess for Facebook CTF, the main problem there always is that you never really know how stable the master branch of the Facebook CTF repo is at the moment, because they don't seem to believe in releases. So you get what is on master there, but technically it should still work. Yeah, And if you have problems importing it anywhere there, then maybe just open a ticket in our CTF tool if you think that it's a problem of the CTF export.
Okay, there were some discussions. Okay, thanks. I have an open branch for automatically submitting flags. And Yannick has also commented on that.
Open branch on Facebook CTF, I mean, you mean.
Yeah, well, Javan, if you're not satisfied, just speak up with the answer. But
Okay.
I think he's fine. So let's proceed.
Okay. So then the final slide, our official success pyramid. So this is the live data basically. So live from the internet, so to say. The JuShop has by now 73 contributors. It's been a flagship project for a while. Okay, everybody knows that. The most interesting statistics is still down here. So the Docker image of the JuShop has by now been pulled 7.4 million times. And I think since the multi-juicer issues, which caused some crazy pulls, have been fixed. I don't know, maybe someone else made a similar mistake, but not too many weeks ago, this was still somewhere at 6.8 million, I think. So this is actually quite nice. We just barely passed or almost scratched, I don't remember, the 4,000 GitHub stars. There's 60,000 downloads of the zip files that we offer with pre-built versions from the JuShop on GitHub, and also still 20,000 in total, 20,000 downloads of those same files from SourceForge. So that's actually quite nice, I would say. Yeah, so that's basically the update I wanted to give. So thank you for still being interested in this project. Follow us everywhere where you like, from Twitter to Reddit, subreddit. We have everything. Simplest way of communication is probably for easy, quick questions about setup problems is our GitHub channel. And if you want to establish a more long-term communication or maybe even start collaborating on the project, then our Slack channel after joining the official OWASP Slack is the best way to actually go for it. And if you just want to make some silly jokes about the JuShop, then just go for Twitter and I happily engage in all the silliness going on there. Yeah, so that's basically
Okay.
all I have.
Well, thanks for the presentation, Björn. Much appreciated.